Welcome to CACE International. I'm fikishac. We have Fred Hóu, baritone saxophone player, who's also the leader of the Afro-Asian music ensemble. How you doing, Fred?
Good, fikishac.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having
today. Me. Okay, Fred, tell me about the Afro-Asian music ensemble.
I started the group when I first came to New York, I think in 1982, and I wanted a musical group that projected the unity between African Americans and Asian Americans, something that was very instrumental and influential in my own development, both in terms of my thinking but also in terms of my cultural work. And I took the name Afro-Asian from the Afro-Asian Unity Conference that was held in the 1950s in Bandung, Indonesia, where the then newly independent countries as well as national independence movements of Africa and Asia, leaders from either those newly independent countries or those movements came together. That included people like Zhou Enlai from China, Julius Nyerere from Tanzania, Kwame Nkrumah from Ghana, Nehru from India, and it was basically to chart an independent path from the two superpower blocs at the time, the United States and then the Soviet Union. And it was the beginning of the burgeoning non-aligned movement, and it spawned a number of other kinds of independent, self-reliant coalition types of efforts internationally. I think OPEC is one example in which oil-producing states came together to deal with their own interests apart from the interests of either the two superpower blocs. So I wanted to develop an ensemble that musically projected that kind of message, in the sense that we as people of color, African Americans and Asian Americans, can interface with each other apart from the dominant white society, that it does not always have to be a black event that has whites supporting it or behind it, or an Asian American event that has whites supporting it or behind it. In other words, the dominant white society does not have to be our reference point. We can be our own reference point. In fact, build a basis of unity that would project a vision into the next century that would call for a new relationship in the world.
So what kind of compositions do you play?
Well, I play now mostly my own music because I didn't really find too many artists, particularly of this generation, we're talking about the period of the 1980s moving into the 90s, with that kind of revolutionary outlook. Most of the musicians are, for better or for worse, preoccupied mostly with their own careers and not about changing the world or projecting a cultural vision apart from that of the commercial mainstream. So I've developed this ensemble with this point in mind of trying to play music that spoke to these critical questions. So I have written a number of extended words, suites, for my ensemble, as well as shorter works. But I've been mostly involved as a composer in developing these extended works, particularly multimedia works.
And
works
what do they say, like? Give me some examples of some of the titles and stuff.
One project is the latest, the title of my latest compact disc, We Refuse to Be Used and Abused Suite. It's a suite dedicated to workers of color, and it was inspired actually by a strike of hotel workers in New York City in the summer of 1986, which literally shut down the city for the summer. And I was very inspired by the Latino and African American women who were pretty much the maids, the domestic workers, people who did the worst kind of work, displaying the iron unity vis-a-vis the Helmsleys and those folks, took on the whole hotel industry, and their courage greatly inspired that particular suite. I have another current work called Turn Pain into Power.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about that.
Well, that title actually comes from I think a slogan that Jesse Jackson put forward.
I heard him say that. I was going to ask you, did that have a connection? Yeah.
Right, and I think the message is a universal one in which oppressed peoples can celebrate their spirit and the history of resistance. That we've always done this, that we have always taken our pain and suffering and channeled it into some form of empowerment, whether as artists in our music or dance or our visual artwork, or just ordinary people, you know, in the sense that the fabric of our culture, particularly the influence and the inspiration of African American music, the spirituals and the blues and so on and so forth, is a music of redemption, is a music of affirmation, is a music in celebration of the spirit, the fortitude, our fortitude to persevere and to one day attain victory. And that's what I'm trying to convey in that particular work, which is a multilingual work. It's in Spanish and in English, and draws from various musical influences, both salsa traditions, African American traditions, as well as Korean folk opera, the pansori tradition. Hmm. So it's both multilingual, multicultural, and also multidisciplinary, and that involves text, both in Spanish and English, as well as visual artwork done by a Puerto Rican painter, Juan Sanchez, and of course the original score, which I wrote.
I've heard you say that you don't perform in clubs. Why not?
I want to break the cycle of exploitation, and I refuse to collaborate in it. And I think many musicians know what I'm talking about in the sense that the clubs are one of the worst forms of exploitation. And in 1987, I swore to myself that I would not do another club in the United States. Other countries is a different matter, but at least from my experience in the United States, it's been the club scene has just been a vicious cycle of complete decline in the conditions and treatment and respect of both the musicians as well as the music. Mm-hmm. So I think that you can look at the Greenwich Village scene. You know, I live in New York City, where you can easily spend about $100 a person going out a night. And of course, you look at who goes to those clubs, right, with the expensive covers and the minimums that are required. And it's mostly aging white men, and we're talking about white men in their late 40s and older, or tourists. And you don't find young people there, and particularly you don't find the kind of nationality diversity that I would like to encourage in my audiences. I want to be able to play in venues that respect the artists as well as the art, and respect the audience too, where the audience can come in at a reasonable amount of payment and be both spiritually, intellectually, and culturally enlightened.
So then how do you earn a living? I don't want to be too personal, but I would think a lot of musicians work a lot in clubs as a way of bringing in income. What other sorts of things do you do?
Until recently, I've had to work many different kinds of jobs. Now I primarily live off of my music and composing. But I think it's important to have a broader context. Most artists in America are not able to make a living doing their artwork or the kind of artwork they would like to do.
That's true.
Okay.
That's true.
And I think that we have to be very resourceful in what we're doing. At the same time, we have to be very clear on what we're trying to achieve. You know, if it's simply fame and success, which unfortunately this generation of artists seems to lust after more and more, and I think it's just part of the social dynamics that this country has moved in, then they'll find either fulfillment or frustration. Many, of course, will find frustration. But if you can make your goals different from the point of artistic satisfaction, and you learn how to survive on what you're able to make, not live beyond your means, or lust after a certain kind of consumerism that most of us are titillated to expect from advertising and so on and so forth, but which we never can get, and that's why we're largely a neurotic group of people. If we can have different kinds of goals and different kinds of methods of acquiring satisfaction and meaning in our life, I think that's very important. I've done everything from working in construction to working in restaurants, temp typist, freelance editor, you name it, I've done it at one point or another.
You've also received grants, and you've been to Harvard, you've lectured. Are you on the lecture circuit?
In part. I'm mostly brought to college campuses, not by the music departments, which are still, I think, one of the continuing bastions of European colonialism in the sense that they don't recognize African American music or really the music of many other Americans who are not of European descent of any cultural worth. So I'm usually brought by ethnic studies programs or black studies or Asian American studies programs. And I usually talk, my talks deal with cultural history. So I've been doing that and also I've been guest faculty member at different colleges. And that's been a way to, in part, supplement my income.
Recently, you did something with a poet out of
New Orleans, right? Yeah. Right, the writer Kalamu Ya Salam.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, major figure from the Black Arts Movement, who's always been in the South.
Mm-hmm.
We did a series of performances and workshops called the Afro-Asian Arts Dialogue, and we've been doing this now for a couple of years.
Okay.
And it's been developed to speak to African Americans and Asian Americans primarily, and to bring these respective groups together, to find our common history of struggle, as well as understand both the similarities as well as differences in the impressions that we have faced.
What did the rebellion in Los Angeles recently behind the Rodney King decision have an impetus in your working now with him, doing more workshops and everything?
We want to do more, partly because I think the commercial media has really picked up or tries to sensationalize differences and divisions between people.
Hmm.
For example, you know, the media tries to portray this Korean black conflict. And of course, there are some real problems going on between these respective communities. At the same time, what the media does not deal with are the efforts towards unity and dialogue, which are always overlooked for more of the sensationalistic voyeurism, if you will,
mm.
of conflict and violence. You know, it's a sort
of sells more papers and it gets more people watching.
It's a form of voyeurism with violence and hatred.
Yeah, the Asian community support your work here, to a large degree.
For those who are aware of it and are conscious of it, yes.
Uh-huh.
And I think that that's a struggle we face in the sense that our marginalization is not self-imposed. The marginalization is a product of the system. You know, in this regard, product of the music business that I have to work in which. The people who own and control the music simply are concerned about the bottom line. And it's nothing about the culture, it's nothing about art, and it's nothing about, much less about larger questions of intergroup relations and unity.
I know you do extra research on music and different cultures. And what we're gonna do here, normally we would break for a visual artist for our CACE gallery, but we're going to do something very special. And we're going to feature you as our visual artist today in our CACE gallery playing with your live baritone. And would you talk to me, or talk to us rather, about the piece you're going to do and how it interplays or interfaces with your research on the different cultures that you're doing now?
One of the things that I've been very interested in is both the immigrant as well as the indigenous culture of Hawaii.
Mm.
Hawaii has become very significant because it's one of the few remaining American colonies, even though it was absorbed into the Commonwealth and became a state in the late 1950s. The Native Hawaiian people there have a struggle very similar to the Native Americans. They actually were a constitutional monarchical government before the United States militarily overthrew them in the late part of the 20th century during the burgeoning Manifest Destiny, the rise of U.S. imperialism. So I've been very interested in the fact that so many immigrant groups, particularly from the Pacific Rim, from China, Japan, the Philippines, came to Hawaii to work on the sugar plantation industry there. And the sugar plantations is another plantation system that we don't, we, meaning Americans in mm-hmm. general, don't know about our own history. We always, we've been informed about the African-American plantation slavery experience of the South, but not about Hawaii. So I'm interested in both the indigenous, the Native Hawaiian culture there, as well as the music of the immigrant groups there. And the piece that I'm going to do is called Soranbushi, which is based on a traditional Japanese peasant work song that talks about the fishing experience. But when they came to Hawaii to work on the sugar plantations, they became plantation workers. So it's a new form, a new song form that developed called the holy holy bushi. Holy holy is a Hawaiian term for the stripping of cane.